Hello, welcome to the Math Reflective. My name is Kathy Dixon, and I'm a sixth grade teacher in Illinois. Thank you to those of you that have been watching my classroom setup videos. I really appreciate it, and I haven't even done a proper introduction. So hello, it's wonderful to meet you over YouTube. For those of you that are new to my channel, I'm heading into a second year piloting Open Up Resources 6-8 Math, and I'm really excited about it. And because I feel a little bit more comfortable with the resource, I now want to raise the bar of my own teaching and learning along with my students. So that's why I've been making these videos, to show how I set up my classroom as well as how I'm going to implement and try to improve by making some goals this year. I also want to tell you a little bit about my channel. So my channel has got three purposes: to talk about teaching, how I teach math, reflect on how I teach and what my students are doing, and also think about how I can impact my own learning and my students' learning so that we can all maximize our potential. And another thing I want to say is, starting off in these first few weeks of school, I'm going to be posting on Instagram an awful lot. So if you're not following me on Instagram, go ahead and find me at The Math Reflective, because I've been putting more things into Instagram stories lately. Hello, it is Wednesday and I'm back in the classroom for a couple hours. And I just wanted to mention about this bulletin board. I use it when I film inside my classroom, but I also want to point out these posters about important women in STEM. And if you haven't had a chance to download these and you're interested in them, go ahead and check them out at Neverthelesses Podcast. You can find them on Instagram, or they have a website, and these posters are free. There's more of them, actually. And I am committing and making sure that this year I incorporate teaching my students a little bit about these women in STEM, because it's very important. So these are some of the other posters, and I just printed them in color and then mounted them on cardstock. I didn't laminate so they wouldn't have glare, but I definitely plan to put these up this year as well. This area is kind of a storage area and a little bit of a teacher area. I don't use it as much anymore, but I definitely put any paper copies that I need over here. Again, we're one-to-one with iPads, so we don't use paper a lot. Although for unit one geometry, there are times that we will use paper often in this unit. But I'll go ahead and put things ahead of time that I need here. This is where our document camera sits, and really we rarely use it. That's why we don't have another table kind of facing, you know, the rest of the class. Is we display using our iPads, and mostly students are displaying. So we don't really use a document camera much, except to maybe go over answers for cool downs. We'll definitely do that. And my co-teacher is left-handed, so we have to kind of change the orientation of the camera a little bit, so it's good for both of us. I just set a little plant back here just to fill in some space, and this is kind of blank right now. I need to fill in the bulletin board here. But yeah, it's a pretty clean area right now. Up in this area, I like to keep passes. These are passes if students are going to come back to your class for lunch, or come back for homeroom, or during homeroom, if they are going to go to another teacher's class, they have to have a pass filled out. And then I think I showed these earlier, that I have these lunch passes, and it's easy for me to just put the date and the children's names when they have to come in at lunch. Then this is where I keep extra like sign out sheets for the bathroom. Real quick, if we run out, I can just go put them over there. And if I'm going to do a seating chart or something, I keep extra templates right here. This is an area I haven't thought about in a couple years, but I think I want to take all these down. These are the 8 mathematical practices posters that we made a couple years ago. We actually had students at the end of the year in sixth grade brainstorm qualities of different superheroes, and then we tried to align them to the mathematical practices, and then students voted on which superhero should go with which one. And we thought that we would have vertical alignment with this and maybe carry it on to 7th and 8th grade, since superheroes are always so popular, but it just kind of fizzled out. We haven't really kept it up. Open Up Resources does such a wonderful job of embedding the mathematical practice, and I feel like it becomes part of our everyday language. We try to focus on one a day that we're working on and intentionally thinking about. So I feel like this really doesn't connect to what we're doing anymore. I feel like I need to do something. Go ahead and add something in the comments below if you have an idea for me, but I think I could better use this space for something else. So I gotta think about that. One resource in my classroom that I have an abundant supply is individual or group dry erase boards. These are double-sided, and I think I have 30 or 40 of them, so plenty. I just need a lot of those dry erase markers. Our school does supply some of those, but we're not supposed to go crazy with them, so I may need to get some donations. So I have a set here on this side of the room. I have a set over there on that side of the room, and then just a sec, I want to show you something else. I also have this size. This is a large size for collaboration and group work. And this is just board that I got from Home Depot, and they cut it there for me for free. So I think each board was $13, and I might have got two of them. I can't remember the size of the board, but I didn't spend more than $25 about 4 years ago. The only thing is the surface is a little bit more difficult to clean, so I feel like you'd have to kind of treat the surface, but I did just scrub these the other day with hand sanitizer, and they came off pretty well, and then I used the spray for dry erase boards, and they're pretty clean. So I envision putting these up along the countertops this year, and then maybe having three on this side and three on that side, and then put them in random groupings, and they can go to town and start working either on the floor or something. And then sometimes last year we had students present their group work, and I just like that size. I like that as for flexibility to have that large size and then also the small size. So I'm excited about that. Another thing that I do use in my classroom is these privacy screens, cubbies, whatever you want to call them. We do have students take these out when we have the unit, end of unit or mid unit assessments. We don't have them do them for exit tickets or cool downs or things like that, because it just takes a little extra time to bring them out. Sometimes we say put up your own personal dividers, and we have students like put up their iPad or like their binders or something like that if we're wanting to do it really quickly. But I have one of these for each student in the classroom. And what I do for a table of four, you really only need to set up two of these. So if you have them kitty corner from each other and you just have two students do it and you kind of line it up in the corner of the desk, it does give enough privacy. And then it doesn't take as much time to clean up. So if we have tables of four, that works nicely. I also love having clipboards in my classroom, and shh, don't tell anybody, but I used to teach a section of literature too for 3 years in a row. So I was able to order these with literature department money. They even say sixth grade lit, but shh, I'm not teaching lit this year, but my mathematicians certainly will enjoy using these in the classroom. I love these for those days you just want students to get up out of their seat and give them some work time with a partner. I think it's good to have those movement breaks. But a backup plan, if you don't have clipboards, you can always use your dry erase boards. Another very handy thing that I have in my classroom is this mini paper cutter. I have had this since I taught first grade. Let's go way back. Back in 1992, 93, I got this paper cutter. It came home with me when I decided to leave teaching for a number of years, so I used it at home for different things. And now that I'm teaching again for the last several years, I use it in my classroom. We do have one at the end of the hall in our workroom where our copier and other paper is, but I like having the smaller one in the classroom. As you can see, these cabinets that are on the opposite wall, that's the wall adjacent to the hallway, I have a lot more of the materials that goes with my math resource, Open Up Resources. So we've got string, we've got little portion cups, we've got receipt tape, register tape, other manipulatives, cardstock here, patty paper. We've got these pattern blocks, we've got Unifix cubes, we've got markers that came, I've got old paper here. Here I have just a column unit, little storage unit, which is great. It was left here when I started teaching here. And this is where I keep other materials and supplies. The students are allowed to go in here anytime they need anything. We've got the measuring tapes, rulers. Up here I've got extra scissors. I've just got an abundance of scissors in this classroom because I took over for somebody who had been here like 15 years or so. And then all this stuff here students can use. I think this is the unit that I'm going to put the visual model templates for students. I haven't filled them yet, but I did make some and I just have to do some cutting. These are just odds and end papers. We have a bingo chart. We have Yahtzee here, graph paper, multiplication charts. That's another thing I want to make accessible. I think I'll go put that over with the geometry toolkit area. Just some different things that I have here that students are allowed to access at any time. So what exactly do I use all these bookcases for? I don't teach literature anymore, so I did get rid of books and different things that I had in here. We have some old textbooks that we're saving just in case we need some old textbooks. And that bottom shelf is emergency subplans. We have to have a central spot where we tell you know, a sub if we somehow don't have sub plans. That would be emergency sub plans. And then I have a lot of these, I have a few of these crates with hanging file folders, and I used to keep everything filed for students, and I would have students help in homeroom, and we would file assessments and different things, and it was a lot of work. And I found that after parent-teacher conferences in November, I would just stack them on an empty shelf, like right there, just throw them all there. And I usually kept them sorted pretty nicely if I had to go through and find one, which was rare. I really never did. So all the sorting and everything all year was not worth my time. Plus, with the cool downs, we give them back to students and they keep those, so we don't really need to file those. I did go ahead and put vocabulary words here. I don't know if I'm gonna use these for the word wall that goes with the anchor chart, or if I'm gonna have students make them, or we also have ones that were given to us to use with open up resources, so not sure about that. For right now, on this shelf, I have some of those dry erase boards stored, and then I have my 6th and 7th grade supplies that our school ordered for us, manipulatives that go with each of the grade levels. I have some old hands-on equation things that we do with equations, some more supplies for open up resources, and then over here, some more of those crates that I have to figure out what to do with this, because this is really wasted space. Some people would be dying for all this space. Oh, on Fridays, we have Fun Friday for homeroom, and students pick out different games and things to play. For those of you that are watching this video that aren't familiar with what I'm talking about with this geometry toolkit, our school is piloting Open Up Resources 6-8 Math for a second year in a row. I'm really hoping that we adopt this resource. It is all aligned to Common Core. It is an open education resource so that it is free to anybody digitally. We pay for the teacher workbooks, and since we're a one-to-one with iPad school, we give our students the PDF versions of the student task statements. For each grade 6, 7, and 8, we start unit 1 with geometry. And I know, geometry is a unit we almost never got to. So in my teaching experience in 6th grade, we actually never got to the geometry. So we would incorporate area and perimeter, you know, review of perimeter and different things into other lessons that we were doing in other units. But Open Up Resources starts with geometry. And part of that is, it's really important in changing your instruction and doing an inquiry-based learning program is to be able to develop those relationships, routines, the way the whole class is about discourse in talking. The teacher's doing much less direct teaching and just as a guide on the side, and the students are driving the learning. So in order to do that, you have to develop a lot of class routines of working together. And it's easier to do that with more unfamiliar concepts. Like they're not already set in their way with algorithms and different things with geometry. And it has an access point for everything, or for everyone. So that is why we start with geometry. So our geometry toolkits are very hands-on, and it's all the different ways that we help students uncover concepts like area, scale drawings, and things like that. So what exactly is in this geometry toolkit? Well, keeping in mind that I have 2 levels of 6th grade math. So I use the 6th grade and the 7th grade curriculum. So some things are for different grade levels in here. Well, if you look inside, we've got colored pencils. We've got patty paper. We've got index cards. I'm going to talk about these in just a minute. I also keep ABCD cards in here. This is great for the which one doesn't belong routine and some of the other multiple choice things that are in Open Up Resource. And it's a great quick call and response system that you can use formative feedback, you know, to see where your class is at. So I like to keep a bag of ABCD cards, and each student has a set for each table group. I also have rulers in here, different scissors. As I said earlier, I have an abundance of scissors. I have protractors in here. Glue sticks, just a couple glue sticks, and then I have highlighters. And the reason I wanted to talk about the index card a little bit more is you see here that the edges are highlighted. So when you get into triangles in Unit 1 and students have to find a height given a base, this highlighting of the corner of the index card just seemed to help some of the students. It didn't, not all of them needed it, but it definitely helped some of the students visually to see how to find that corresponding height given a base. So that's a good extra little tip there. That's it. Okay, I want to go ahead and demonstrate how you would find the list for what
is comprised in the geometry toolkit. So I went to openupresources.org. I have a login and I went to unit one for sixth grade. Go ahead and choose lesson two. And then if you scroll down, you can see where it says required materials. You could just click on geometry toolkits. And then you can see where it'll list for grade 6 and 7 and 8 what you need. So for grade 6, tracing paper, graph paper, colored pencils, scissors, and index cards to use as a straight edge or to mark right angles. And then it tells you a little bit something about tracing paper. What we use is patty paper. So that's how you find what's in the geometry toolkits. It took me a while to figure that out.
Throughout the year, we encouraged a lot of collaboration with students. And at the end of the year, our administration, several people from the district came and did a learning walk just specifically for math. It was the first time that they had ever done that with some math criteria in mind. And then we met in May for our last committee meeting, and they definitely said that our students are collaborating and discussing math and solutions and how they do problems more than they ever have before. But they also saw that they weren't really helping to push the knowledge or dive deeper. So they weren't asking the right questions or pushing another student's thinking to help them get to that next level of depth of understanding. So a student might share their solution and maybe there's an error in it and the other student's just kind of saying, oh, okay, well I did it this way. So we really want to push their thinking better this year. And I know that's something we also talked about at the Hive conference, of having sentence frames for students to know, like, what kinds of things would they say, you know, to give them some examples of that. Okay, so I popped in for about an hour and a half today because I wanted to film a special video for my students, and then also I wanted to follow up about the sentence frames that I was talking about earlier in the video. I went ahead and printed out something that was saved, I think, on the Facebook community site on sentence frames. Somebody had put shared their Google Doc. So then what I did is I cut and pasted it so it would be front to back. So half of the sentence frames on this side, half on this side, and then I printed them out on cardstock. So maybe I'll start with these for the school year and slowly over time, you know, explain to students the different areas and how this is divided up. Like this says the language function is describe, explain, justify, generalize, critique, compare and contrast, represent, and interpret. And there's statements as well as questions for each of those areas. And I know that might be really overwhelming for students at first, so I haven't thought at all yet about how I want to incorporate this. I will talk to my math team and we'll figure it out together, but just wanted to follow up on that. I'm going to go ahead and put the link to this document that's double-sided below in the description box in case you're interested in using it as well. Just wanted to give you an up-close view of the sentence stem cards so that you know better what I was talking about. So the other side looks like this. Until next time, are you ready for more?